Hello, Sophie here. So as I was editing last week's video all about 3D masks, I realized there's a whole side to this approach that I didn't even cover. Feel free to check out that video if you haven't. It's not necessary before watching this one. Also, in that video, when I was sharing pieces for which I had used that technique, I shared this one. And so as a bonus, at the end of this video, I'm also going to really quickly cover how to get this drawn in effect. But yeah, for this video, I thought we could revisit this piece. I actually do have a whole video about how I made it 2 weeks ago. And I'm reusing it not only because, you know, I have the meshes, so they're there, that saves me some steps. But also, I mean, I think this is just a great way to show one of my favorite things about grease pencil, which is that there are so many different ways you can approach it and so many different techniques. All right, let's go. So as you can see, I've cleaned it up a bit, and what we have left is my 5 meshes. So we have the hair, I'll go back into solid view. We have the head, the body of her sweater, and we have a mesh for the right arm and the left arm. Let's also say for this example that we want each mesh to have a different color in the final piece. So I also have my grease pencil stroke object. So this contains the line art that was drawn on top of the mesh. And it also has these two scribbly color layers, which were from my first version of this piece. And so we'll hide them for now, but we can add them back in at the end to see the different kinds of looks that we can get with this. And then we have this scribble layer, which may not make much sense now, but that is where the magic happens. But yeah, I'll go through this next step quite quickly, so check out last week's video if you want, once again, the detailed explanation of this. So all my meshes already have a solidify modifier from the first time that I worked on this piece. So I'll just go ahead and select each of my meshes, hit F3, search convert, and then select convert to grease pencil. And then I just want to check this box that says keep original. There's no decimate modifier on these because the geometry is already so simple, it's really not necessary. So then we want to go into each new grease pencil object, go into object data properties, select the fill layer, and in this drop-down menu, we're gonna select copy layer to object and move it to our main stroke object. Then we can just shift select all of them and delete them. Then I'll just go into my main grease pencil stroke object and with this arrow key, move them all to the bottom of the layers. And then we'll just go back to our meshes and hide all of the solidify modifiers once again. So far, everything is the same as how we did it last week, but here's the difference. So like last week, we have our 2D layer, but unlike last week, where we masked, what did we do? What are we doing today? Okay, unlike last week, where we masked the 2D layer to the 3D fill layers, we're going to do the reverse. So we're going to mask the 3D fill layers to this 2D scribble layer. So this means that we can turn its opacity from 1 down all the way to 0. One of the things I really like about this particular way of doing this method is that we can give each area a different color, so each grease pencil layer created from a different mesh can have its own color. So we do that by going into the materials properties, and then we can see there's a material for each of our meshes that we converted. So I'm just going to use the color picker and draw from the original illustration. Oh, I should probably read what I'm... So now we have our solid blocks of color, which is totally fine if that's the end look you want to go for, but what I really like is like sketchy textured looks. And so that's where our 2D scribble layer is going to come in. So let's go back into object data properties. And like last week, we're just going to select each of the 3D fill layers, check the box that says mask, and this time we're going to look for our scribble layer. Ooh. No matter how many times I do this, I don't think it will ever stop impressing me. So let's say we want to use this for the base of our illustration. So, you know, these are how our base colors are going to look. They're going to have this sketchy texture. And so the big pro of this method is that you can have these different colors for each of these different areas. But the biggest con, at least for me, who is obsessed with getting like those subtle differences in color that I talk about in almost every video, is that because we've just given the materials colors, each of these sections is just its own solid block of color. And so typically what I would do in this case, in order to get back in those subtle differences in color, is I would do like I have already done for the original piece. I would have these sketchy layers. So I have a video where I talk all about my brushes, but basically these layers were done with my, I call it my pencil crayon brush, which just has some hue variation built into it. And with that brush, I would just scribble over the mesh. So let's see what we can do with this. We could always mask these as well to the scribble layer. So that's definitely something, I think, slightly too chaotic for my taste. Maybe the gaps between the scribbles are a bit too wide. So an easy way to fix this is to go into the modifiers properties. And so I didn't clean out these from the first time that I did this piece. They're basically mostly just to recolor some stuff, so I'm going to leave it. I also have a video where I go more in depth into that if you're curious. But just for today, we'll add a thickness modifier and an influence. Let's apply it to the scribble layer. And so we could turn this value up a bit. So we still see those scribbly lines. They're just perhaps not quite so in your face. Literally, in her face. And then one of my favorite things to do when I have these kinds of scribble layers is I add a noise modifier. To be honest, I mean, I think we should just stop here. No. So I'm going to open the influence box and once again apply it to the scribble layer. And then if we press play, what do we get? She's alive! So I already have my camera movement set up. And so another thing that I briefly talked about in last week's video, but didn't actually fully explain how to do, is we're going to want to parent the 2D layer to the camera if we want it to rotate with the camera and for this not to happen. And so we can very easily do that by going back into Object Data Properties, selecting our scribble layer, and then underneath Masks, if we open up Relations, we can select our camera as our parent. And then you can see the scribble layer stays within the exact same areas of the frame. So then I also kept some of the 2D flower layers from the original piece. So we can see how everything is looking together. Looks like we're having some conflicts with overlapping grease pencil layers, so I'll just quickly fix that up. All I did was move the main grease pencil stroke object that contained the 2D scribble layer up a bit along the Y axis. So I'm really liking how it's looking already, but one last thing, as promised, how to make your whole piece look like it's being drawn in. Once again, with the modifier. So we'll go back into the modifiers, and we want what's called the build modifier. So there's two different modes for the build. There's sequential, where all the strokes get drawn in one after another. And then the other mode is concurrent. And I can't say I've used this very much, to be honest. I just think it gives such an incredibly cool effect. So originally I was just going to have this influence the scribble layer. This is what I've done for other pieces where all of the layers are masked to some 2D scribble layers. And so we would be able to see that really well if, you know, the line art was masked to the scribble layer and so were the other two color layers. It's almost like an Etch-a-Sketch filling in, which is definitely a really cool look in its own right. But I'm not gonna lie, I was kind of obsessed with just the look of everything being drawn in together at the same time. So I'm actually curious to see, what would this piece look like if this same build modifier was applied to all of the grease pencil layers, the grease pencil objects, sorry. So a very easy way to share modifiers between different grease pencil objects is up here in your scene collection. If you open up your grease pencil object, and then you open up your modifiers, you can find your modifier, and then you can just drag them into your other grease pencil objects. And it's just my favorite thing. So what I think would be a final really cool thing that we could do for this experiment is, since we're having the strokes draw in, we can also have them be drawn out. So that's using the same modifier. So we can just select and duplicate it. And then in transition, instead of grow, we want shrink. And so the first build modifier starts at the beginning of the animation and it goes for 100 frames. And so I think for this one, we have a 300 frame animation. So let's start it at frame 200. And from experience, I find the drawing out, for whatever reason, feels a bit more natural when it's a bit quicker. So maybe let's have it go over 50 frames instead of 100. Ah, so cool. And yes, I absolutely want to apply this modifier, not apply, share this modifier with all of the strokes. It's so cool. I can't. So then to turn this into something final, I would just give all the meshes a holdout material. And then I would just give the whole thing a background image. And I will absolutely not make you wait through the entire rendering of this because I'm sure it will take a very long time. But I'll just share now the final result of today's experiment. So that's the video. I hope this was helpful for you. This was a bit more spur of the moment than usual. If this rainy week has taught me anything, is that if you film by natural lighting, you gotta take whatever chance you can get. But no, it ended up being a lot of fun. So, as always, liking and subscribing is a big help to this channel. You can find me everywhere at Sophie Jantak, and I will see you very soon. Bye.